College Hospital, London, UK. He has got 10 years of experience in hepatology.
Respected gentlemen, first of all, I want to thank all the office bearers of IMA Kodambakkam and especially Dr. Vector Sai sir for giving me this opportunity. So today the topic is about fatty liver. I'm sure everybody has seen fatty liver and every day we see fatty liver. But what is so special about this topic? Because it can manifest in any form. It can lead to diabetes, it can lead to hypertension, it can lead to hypercholesterolemia, metabolic syndrome, gallstones, PCOD. I'll be covering those things slowly. So before we start into the topic, we just want to brief a few cases. So we'll just get into the picture. So this was a 44-year-old lady from Chennai, a diabetic on treatment with a BMI of 28. On general checkup, she has found her fatty liver. Extremely commonly we see every day. LFT is normal, viral markers negative. So this is basically a steatosis in the liver. There is no damage, so this has fat in the liver. Next case, a young male, 29-year-old male from Northeast, he comes with some dull aching pain, some pricking pain in the right upper quadrant, on and off. He is a class of obesity he has. He is, as expected, his SGPT is 104, viral markers are negative. Virus and autoimmune workup negative, ultrasound is grade 2 fatty liver. So this is fatty liver with damage in the liver, that is inflammation, that is second stage. Third, 58-year-old patient comes from Orissa, diabetic again on treatment, complaints of 3 episodes of vomiting of blood since 2 months, no other decomposition, good sensory functions. Imaging showing CLD. So this is fatty liver into cirrhosis, the last stage. So how do we define fat? So these are three commonly we see cases of hepatic presentations of fatty liver. So fatty liver is basically defined on histology as more than 5% fat on biopsy is defined as fatty liver. In the absence of, please note, in the absence of excessive alcohol, defined as 2 drinks, that is 20 grams alcohol in men and 10 grams in women. So fatty liver, it's almost affects 30% of general population and 80% of people with obesity and diabetes will have fatty liver. It is considered as a hepatic manifestations of metabolic syndrome. So this is a spectrum which we already saw. So this is the fatty liver, steatosis, then steatohepatitis and culminates in cirrhosis. So what is the natural history of fatty liver? A patient with only fatty liver, they progress when they have diabetes, older age, or they have higher body weight. They progress to NASH, that is fatty liver with damage. Over a period of 3 years, 25 to 30% patients progress to NASH. And once they develop NASH, they have this comorbidity in the genetic polymorphisms also. They progress to cirrhosis in the next 10 to 20 years with a risk of 5 to 10%. But suppose they develop NASH with fibrosis, please note fibrosis. Then the chance of progressive cirrhosis is at least 30%. So from 5% goes to 30%, they develop NASH with fibrosis. So this is where we have to prevent this stage before this stage starts. And we have also seen in non-cirrhotic patients HCC. And commonly nowadays because of good antivirus, hepatitis B is less. And especially Tamil Nadu, hepatitis B is very less. So more commonly we see in normal levels HCC because of fatty liver. So is fatty liver a disease of the West only? I don't think so. If you see the world map, the around 31% is there in South Asia, fatty liver. And India comes around 30%. This is mainly because of rising westernization of the diet, sedentary lifestyle, urbanization, metabolic syndrome and obesity. That leading to the epidemic of fatty liver. And that is why India is becoming the diabetes capital of the world, or maybe it has become. So the different differences are there, but most important what we should remember is in Asians, they are more prone for type 2 diabetes, metabolic syndrome and fatty liver than Europeans. And we have also seen an entity called lean NASH. So people who are lean, thin, they also get developed fatty liver, and it is more common in India compared to the West. And they are also more prone for cardiovascular disease. So coming to Indian data, Fatty liver has been reported in around 90-30%, and fibrosis metabolic syndrome 50%. And fatty liver is the most important cause of unexplained lysine transaminases, unexplained cause of cirrhosis, and unexplained cause of HCC. So this is very important to identify. And this is Indian data I'm quoting. Coming to gender-wise association, this was a study where 1,000 patients were screened, and fatty liver found in 45% patients. And in men, the males, the risk of fatty liver was 1.6% high, and with a BMI of more than 25. Whereas in women, if their age is more than 40 years, blood sugar more than 100, and triglycerides more than 150, they were prone for fatty liver. This was our data where we have seen in liver disease cirrhotics also, the second commonest cause of cirrhosis after alcohol was fatty liver. So these are the different causes of fatty liver. The important ones are drugs. These are secondary causes like viral hepatitis, autoimmune drugs, toxins, important metabolic conditions like hypothyroidism, hypopituitarism, Cushing syndrome, and nutritional like TPM. So this is a schematic diagram where we see the different spectrum of fatty liver and medicines, hypoglycemia, hormonal disturbances. They are all more prone for NASH. And important surgeries like pancreatic biliary diversion, TPM, they all predispose to NASH. So the bedrock for fatty liver are liver manifestation, cardiac manifestations, and beta cell failure. Next. So fatty liver is definitely because of more sweets, if we develop fatty liver, but it leads to a lot of sore manifestations. Next slide. So this is the pathophysiology of fatty liver. Basically, obesity increases the insulin resistance and endothelial dysfunction that leads to metabolic syndrome and fatty liver. Next. So the central role of insulin resistance is important because when there is obesity, there is insulin resistance, and reduced adiponectin increases leptins that leads to reduced hepatic oxidation and increased de novo lipogenesis and increased fatty liver, free fatty acids flux. Next slide. Yeah, so this is the central node of insulin resistance. So there's more intake and reduced output that is leading to fatty liver. Next slide. So this was an interesting study from India. It was made from Odisha, where they have seen out of 650 people, they are on biopsy, they are diagnosed fatty liver, and they saw out of 650 people, 24% had diabetes, and please note, pre-diabetes in 22%. So they have not developed diabetes, they have only impaired glucose tolerance, but in 22% of people have pre-diabetes in fatty liver in India. And these fatty liver patients with type 2 diabetes have higher blood sugar, higher cholesterol, central obesity, insulin resistance compared to controls, seen in this graph. This is another interesting study where in a retrospective cohort, they had seen that those people with fatty liver had higher incidence of diabetes, but when they took lifestyle and dietary modifications and the fatty liver improved, the incidence of diabetes also came down. So by reducing the risk of fatty liver, even the risk of diabetes is coming down, incidence also comes down. What about cardiac manifestations? That is the heart of the matter. Next. So in this diagram, this was a cohort study over a period of 20 years. And they had seen that compared to the reference population, the liver-related morbidity was 2.8% in fatty liver compared to 0.2% in controls. They were also at a 5.6% chance of extrahepatic malignancy. And these were most importantly, cardiovascular morbidity and mortality was 15% in fatty liver compared to 7% in controls. So those patients with fatty liver were predisposed for cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. Next slide. Even in this retrospective cohort in Sweden, over a period of 26 years, they had seen out of 229 patients, they had seen of fatty liver, they had seen 41 people had cardiovascular deaths and fibrosis stage on histology significantly. on liver histology was associated with all-cause liver-related and cardiovascular mortality. This was a longitudinal study. This is another study where they have seen that fatty liver predicts cardiovascular morbidity. Now this is important. So this is a nice study where they have seen that in fatty liver, the chance of brachial artery ischemia by compressing the brachial artery, when they saw ischemia and thrombo-mediated vasodilation, they saw when it was endothelial dependent, that only based on ischemia, they saw in fatty liver the response was poorer compared to those who were controls. And the response was even worse in fatty liver with steatohepatitis compared to only steatosis. And this was statistically significant. So basically, in this conceptually, they have explored in this study where by which fatty liver causes blood vessels to become thickened, increases atherosclerosis, and that predisposes to cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. So this is the summary slide of cardiovascular risk. Excess vascular and liver-related deaths have been reported. The predictors of cardiovascular death, such as myocardial infarction, are intimately associated with fatty liver. This longitudinal studies, population studies have shown they have increased risk 60% mortality in fatty liver, and association of fatty liver and cardiovascular disease is established. What about gallstones, which we secondly almost every day we see gallstones. So this was an interesting study from Korea where they had screened 7,000 people, and they had given a questionnaire, underwent medical examination and ultrasound scanning over a period of 10 years. And they had graded on ultrasound fatty liver, and presence of gallstones were noted. In this study, in this very nice study, they saw the prevalence of fatty liver was 40% and prevalence of gallstones was 4.5%. And most importantly, on multivariate analysis, only older age and the higher the grade of fatty liver on ultrasound independently predicted the risk of gallstones. So fatty liver basically not only causes atherosclerosis, it also thickens the bile, and that's why the predisposed for gallstones. So when you are treating patients with gallstones, we should also emphasize on fatty liver. So because they can also develop primary CVD stones even after laparoscopic cholecystectomy if you don't treat the primary problem. What about fatty liver? The liver manifestation, the tip of the iceberg. So like we already saw, steatosis, they usually have no symptoms. They're only picked up in general examination on master checkup. Steatohepatitis, like our patient, we had some faint upper quadrant. They have all non-specific symptoms, but they will have steatohepatitis. And cirrhosis, we find cirrhosis of portal hypertension. So I'm not going to go into this details. These are all the manifestations of portal hypertension. This is an interesting concept I wanted to show. Does fatty liver run in families? So this was a study from US where they have seen out of 1,000 patients, they have seen that diabetes was associated independently with NASH, fibrosis and advanced fibrosis, and family history, especially in non-diabetics, was also associated with NASH and NASH with fibrosis. This was our study from Delhi where we had screened 1,000, this was in liver disease. That study was in diabetic patients. This was in liver disease, cirrhotic patients. And we have seen, we have basically taken family history of metabolic traits. The metabolic traits like family history of diabetes, hypertension, cardiac disease, metabolic syndrome and all. And in those people, in those patients with family history, with first degree relatives having this positive personal traits, family's metabolic traits, they had lower age at diagnosis of when they present with liver disease, they were much younger, they were more sicker, and they had more chance of decompensation. So they were more sicker, means they have underlying fatty liver. On top of their drinking alcohol or hepatitis B or hepatitis C, they progress much faster. So that says that these patients are prone for fatty liver because of genetic background. On top of that, with second insult, they become much sicker faster. What about PCOD? So this is a conceptual diagram where they see, because of insulin resistance, central obesity causing insulin resistance that leads to PCOD and hyperaldosteronism that worsens fatty liver. And these are multiple studies where they have seen almost 20 to 50% association is there, prevalence of PCOD in ladies with fatty liver. So by treating fatty liver, we are actually improving the PCOD also, I think. approach to diagnosis. So most important starts with history taking, medical history, or we had always seen the secondary causes of fatty liver, which has to be ruled out. Then examination, basically anthropometry is important, and also signs of liver disease can be identified. Important liver function test, in that this is a study from Chandigarh on what is a normal. Now we see different labs have less than AST, like Ramchandra. They say AST less than 50, AST less than 50 is normal. But actually, the normal value is 20. So we are missing that big 20 to 50 group we are missing in STPT, SGOT. So any patient with even AST of 40 also, we should screen for fatty liver. They will have underlying inflammation, they are not normal, they are not just fatty liver alone. And others like other parameters of metabolic syndrome like glucose, cholesterol, all these things we have to check. And important also, viral staining. Ultrasound, grading of steatosis is done. These are different grades. And what non-invasive tests like FibroScan, RPE are available, which give a non-invasive estimation of fat content and fibrosis and inflammation content in the liver. And this has to be repeated at time intervals, so dynamic changes we see, and on treatment we define whether the patient is improving or not. Even CT, MRI, some data is there, but they are quite expensive, so we don't usually do for fatty liver alone unless there are some other associated diseases. Biomarkers also been developed. Liver biopsy, especially when they are, like for example, lean NASH. Lean patients and they are having persistently raised enzymes, or they have concomitant viral infections. So only certain situations we need to do biopsy. Even the gold standard is biopsy, but we don't need to do in general population always. So what is the management of fatty liver? Basically, it starts with weight loss, vaccination, stopping any amount of alcohol, screening for cardiovascular disease, and generally do not recommend supplements like L52, anything doesn't matter. This is a diet, this is a study where they are seen by giving in less than 90 kilos around 1200 kilocalories, and more than 90 kilos 1200 to 1500 kilocalories. They are seeing that the reduction of NAS score was seen from baseline based on biopsy. So biopsy improvement was seen by following a low calorie diet. So this is another rat model where they have seen that by giving a low calorie diet, the intrahepatic fat mass, intrahepatic triglycerides, and this percentage improvement in insulin resistance, insulin sensitivity index also improved by giving a low carbohydrate diet. So important to notice, we should give a low carbohydrate diet and do not emphasize on low fat diet, it's low carbohydrate. These are different drugs, the different sites, we are not going into details. So the commonly used drugs are vitamin E. We have seen some data on pentoxifilin. By combining pentoxifilin with vitamin E, we not only improve inflammation but also help in regression of fibrosis. Like I already showed in the natural history, those patients with fatty liver and fibrosis, they are more prone for cirrhosis and worsening cardiovascular complications than only fatty liver. So by treating fatty liver, we should mainly aim for reversing the fibrosis. And these are the different diabetic medications. They not much role in liver histology improvement. But some new data is coming about saroglitazar. It's combination of PPAR alpha and gamma. And we have also seen in patients with fatty liver, with doing some relatively better with saroglitazar. But more Indian data is required before we start replicating. So the three-pronged approach of fatty liver management is diabetes management, cardiovascular disease, and liver-related disease. So it needs a multidisciplinary approach with basic role of a physician, a hepatologist, cardiologist, dietitian, physiotherapist, everything. So this is the concept of MEAT approach. I'll just go into only the headlines. M for make the diagnosis. E, establish the metabolic syndrome components like hypertension, dyslipidemia, obesity. Assess the lifestyle and start seeing how we can do lifestyle modifications. Therapeutic dietary advice, which I already said, we should emphasize on it. Low carbohydrate diet, liver biopsy only in certain situations, help for liver biopsy. Oh, suppose like in Western settings they usually try to see internal investigator-led trials, clinical trials. Main thing is A for advice, that is what we do, target heart rate, blood pressure, cholesterol, and all we follow up. And important follow up is every 3 to 6 months we follow up these patients. how are they progressing? Do we need to do fibro scan and the liver parameters are improving? So based on this enabled clinic approach, they had seen, but the normalization of liver parameters was achieved in 55% patients, and even weight reduction also was seen. So advantages of a multidisciplinary approach: improved glycemic control, lower hurdles for risk factors, newer therapeutic protocols, and we identify areas of further research. So, next. So the way forward. So primary care physician, cardiologist, diabetologist, hepatologist, based on checklist of the different parameters what we check. Next line. Next. Yeah, so they identify metabolic syndrome, liver, fatty liver, ultrasound showing fatty liver. Next, they come to the fatty liver clinic where they are seen by dietitian, diabetologist, physician, liver specialist and physical trainer. Next. Standard protocol, follow-up for diabetes, hypertension and dyslipidemia. We give a nutrition also based on 7-day recall. We also follow walk and exercise, monitor response to treatment and intervention. And if they have NASH, we also start treatment for NASH based on by giving vitamin E, pentoxifilin, so many drugs are there. And finally, I want to say it's the central role of a physician, that's important. And others also pitch in that's how we give comprehensive care to patients with fatty liver. So it has a disease with many facets. It is increasingly prevalent, especially in our country, with increased risk of liver-related and cardiovascular mortality. It requires a multidisciplinary approach and, most important, lifestyle modifications and dietary advice. So I come from Department of Hepatology at K.N. Chandan. So we started the department in August 2018. This is sixth center as a whole and third center in the country to have a with an in-house transplant program having a DM hepatology. We have done 58 transplants till now. We did the first successful living donor transplant last year in June, and we also did the first successful pediatric emergency liver transplant last month. We also have started public health initiatives like liver awareness program, free hepatitis workshops, screening camps, and so on. Thank you very much.
Any questions, please?
What would you advise a patient who has just been diagnosed as a fatty liver, grade 2, not grade 1, grade 2, a poor patient? What would you advise on diet or medication or how to go about? What would you say about what the prognosis is? How to generally guide them for the rest of what the prognosis is?
So when suppose a person has come with fatty liver, we also see whether they have associated diabetes, metabolic syndrome, what are the different components of metabolic syndrome they have. Then we check for, because of cost constraint, we can check ALT, and we can, as you ordered, an ultrasound and viral screening, especially hepatitis B should be done. And then give them vaccination for hepatitis B. If SGBT is normal, it's just a diet and lifestyle modifications. Diet means low carbohydrate diet and lifestyle modifications, and follow up regularly, along with the routine diabetic medications are to be given.
How long can this go on?
Well, suppose if they are improving with lifestyle and dietary modifications, they do not require treatment when there is no inflammatory activities for fatty liver. Only with this inflammatory activity, with increasing transaminitis only, we should start treatment. But before that, only just diet, lifestyle and diabetic medications and sugar control is more than sufficient that they don't progress.
When do you start vitamin E? What is the indication for starting vitamin E?
When they have persistently raised liver enzymes and other factors have been ruled out contributing to raised liver enzymes, then we can give vitamin E.
What is the dose?
We usually give 400 IU, twice a day. Even if you give up to 3 to 6 months, and then follow up regularly, after that we can stop. We don't need to continue. Even the newer diabetic drugs like sitagliptin, linagliptins have some role in reducing the transaminitis by formin. So along with that we can place, because they will be there for lifelong. Along with it, just a small boost we can give with this, and then follow up. But most important, we should emphasize to the patient is diet and lifestyle, and then only comes medications. Or they just simply think by eating medicine I'm fine, so I don't need to do anything. They'll again come back with fat, with increased liver enzymes.
But which medication reverses the fatty liver?
So there are many drugs are there. Some people use silymarin, vitamin E, acetylcholic acid, pentoxifilin. But what the clinical trials and the data is showing, only vitamin E and some role of pentoxifilin has been shown. Other drugs like acetylcholic acid, if they don't have gallstones, it doesn't require. Patients do not require acetylcholic acid or the silymarin or this thing. Yes, cetirizine beta, and they're not required in that area.
Is pentoxifilin available?
Yes, yes, sir.
It
was not there for a short while.
Yes.
Now it's available. But they have some intolerance there, some patients. So usually what I follow is they have fibrosis based on fibroscan or RFE. Then only I give pentoxifilin, or usually I just for transaminitis, I usually don't give pentoxifilin because they'll be poorly compliant. They develop side effects and they stop the medicine.
Patients with fatty liver and hepatitis B, what percentage are positive?
Yes, that's a very good question, sir. So, if we can do liver biopsy, that's the best thing. Otherwise, we can just change the hepatitis B. See the DNA. If the DNA is high, you start treatment. If the DNA is low or DNA is less than 20,000, they are carriers. This E negative and E positive. Then we don't need to treat for antivirals, we just have to start. That's how we diagnose why the what's the reason for HGPT elevation. If that is negative, then we can treat, we can only focus on fatty liver. But we follow the usual screening, the protocols for those patients with hepatitis B. For example, 6-monthly ALT, ultrasound, yearly one DNA, that should be done.
So ALT is mostly
AST,
right?
Yes, in fatty liver, ALT is more sensitive than AST. If you can achieve the basically there are two components in fatty liver. One is NASH, one is inflammation, and second is fibrosis. Usually all these medicines like vitamin E, silymarin, acetylcholine, they all help in regression of the inflammation, but they don't help in regression of fibrosis. So only few drugs like pentoxifilin have been shown that there is regression of fibrosis. But newer drugs like obeticholic acid and all are coming up by this year, and they will be coming. So maybe those drugs like their phosphonoxidase inhibitors, receptor pathway blockage, they have some role in regression of fibrosis. But even saroglitazar, which the Zydus Pharma keeps propagating about saroglitazar, they have shown only regression of NASH, that is inflammation, but they have not shown regression of fibrosis. And if you regress fibrosis, the cardiovascular risk, the progression of cirrhosis, all that comes down. So what we have, even the international experts, they say, instead of emphasizing more on drugs, if you emphasize on diet and lifestyle, actually they reverse fibrosis. And we have seen in the data, those patients have improved on lifestyle modification, the fatty liver came down, even diabetes reversed. And the population studies are there. Long term, 20 years follow-up studies are there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.